What's up, guys? Today we're going to go over the thermal expansion mod. This video is going to serve as a quick start guide in order to be able to dip your feet into the mod. This will go over how you can, you know, generate power, what you can kind of do with some of the machines, how to operate the machines, so on and so forth. So with that, let's jump right in. Alright, so first I think I just want to go over a couple of machines that you might want to use at the very beginning of using thermal expansion. My favorite two are the redstone furnace and the pulverizer. So what the redstone furnace will do is it will smelt items using redstone flux, which is a form of energy, rather than some sort of combustible fuel like coal. And then the pulverizer will pulverize objects such as iron ore or whatever into crushed materials, in that case pulverized iron. So the reason you might want a redstone furnace is so you can save on your fuels. It can also go faster than a normal furnace would, so you can just get things done faster. The pulverizer has a lot of very useful recipes. One in particular is that, you know, if you could guess, if you smelt an iron ore like this, you'll get one iron ingot out. Perfectly acceptable. That's exactly what you would expect to do that. But if you use a pulverizer to pulverize iron ore, you'll actually get two pulverized iron out. And then the redstone furnace can smelt pulverized iron into an ingot at a one-to-one ratio, which means that you can basically double the amount of iron you get, or whatever metal, from the amount of ore, right? Because then we can smelt this again and get iron ingots back out. So this shows just one useful chain of machines you can do in thermal expansion. All right, so when you open up one of the machines, you'll be met with a series of tabs on the sides here. The top left one is your energy usage. I rarely expand this one because you can kind of glance at the storage right here and, you know, see what you're looking for. Information, it just gives you a little bit more information on the machine. The top right one is augmentations, where you can put machine upgrades that can upgrade things like speed. It can make your furnace specialized to do certain things. I won't get too much into that right now. You can also have redstone control. So I have it on redstone ignored, which means that it's just on all the time and it doesn't take any redstone signals. If I want, for example, a way to remotely shut off and turn on the machine, I can set it to one of these two, and then I can use a redstone signal to turn off and on the machine. The bottom right here is the most important tab, I think, and this is how we can configure the inputs and outputs to the machine. And a lot of work goes into making sure that these are correct and that they will cooperate with what you're trying to do. So as an example of how you can use that configuration tab, the chain of recipes that I showed you earlier where we can pulverize iron and get two iron ingots out of it, it would be nice if we were able to make it where the pulverizer output its pulverized iron into the furnace, and then the furnace smelted it, and we didn't have to do the logistics ourselves. So what we can do is we can put the machines adjacent to each other. I'm going to put the pulverizer on top. And what we do then is we can configure the sides here in order to make sure that things are getting routed correctly. So these are sides on the machine, like the physical sides. This one is the bottom, so this will be facing into the redstone furnace. This one is the back, I believe. Yeah, the back. And then this one's the left, the right, and then the top of the machine. Same goes for all of them, but most of them will have this configuration. Now, they have colors, and what the colors indicate is which slot it's going to input or output into. And you know, the colors also indicate if it is an input or output, but typically it'll just correspond to slots that will be inputs or outputs. So for example, the pulverizer has three slots. One is an input where we put iron, and then there's two outputs. And usually if we look at some of the recipes here, sometimes there's a secondary output and you have to deal with that secondary output, right? So in my case, I think it does pulverized nickel as a secondary output and pulverized iron as the primary output. So I kind of want to separate these things, right? What we can do is we can click on the sides here, and it's left click and or right click. We'll go two different directions, and we can make it such that the slots will be different colors. So in my case, I want to make the slots different colors. So I think it's red and yellow. Yeah, because I don't want these two things going to the same place necessarily. In the case of pulverized nickel and iron, I guess we could throw it into the furnace, but let's just say that I don't want to smelt the nickel for some reason. So what we can do is we have yellow on the side, and now we have red facing into the furnace. I already configured these so we can see that the furnace is actually already grabbing the iron. What we also need to do is make sure that auto output and auto input or whatever is enabled, because auto output will take these slots and it will try to push any items into them to anything connected to the machine. So in this case, if I turn this off, I think it will stop out, assuming this one's off also, it'll stop outputting it into the furnace, and it's going to stop here because it's running out of energy. So we need to do auto output, and then we have to make sure that the furnace on the bottom is configured correctly. So we see that the input slot here should be blue, and that one's on the top, which is facing into the pulverizer. So everything's good there. If it was like this, it would not work. So we need to make sure that it's the right color. I don't need these slots either. Okay. And then just with that also, we can do a step further and use chests in order to make it where we don't have to... I'm trying to get on there. We don't have to do the logistics ourselves even more. So now I can put the iron ore in here. And you can see that it's not pulling into the pulverizer because we don't have auto input on. We want auto input on, and then it'll pull into the pulverizer. And then here we have auto output, and it'll take this slot and push into, we can see that that's orange there, into this chest. So now, as you can see, they ran out of power, so they're not actually doing anything. So we do need a way to power them. But the logistics of the machine should be hooked up such that if I put ore up here, it'll go all the way down, all the way down and smelt the things and put them into this chest. I haven't dealt with this one yet, but we'll deal with that once we get the power ready. All right, so in order to get the power for the thermal foundation machines, if you're using a modpack, you have a number of options. It's really convenient if you're using a modpack because usually you have options like nuclear craft solar panels or tech reborn solar panels, and these are my two personal favorites. And basically all you have to do is just hook them up to the machine and it will power it, albeit slowly sometimes, but it will power it. And then we could hook it up to like the pulverizer and it'd work the same way. I'm going to have to assume that we don't have a mod pack and that we don't have those options. So I'm going to explain it through only thermal expansion objects themselves. So we have a number of, I think it's engines. Let's do a thermal expansion. So we have a number of options for engines here. Because this is a quick start guide, I will use the most basic form of the energy creation, which is the steam dynamo. And then we have, more options if you want to get further into that. So I already have one right here. And if we place one, let's place it facing that way. We can see that basically it asks for a fluid, and it, water works just well. And then you ask for some sort of combustible fuel. Which is kind of silly because like we replaced the redstone furnace so that we didn't have to use combustible fuel, and then now we have to use combustible fuel. Still remember that we're getting double the iron that we would have normally though. So this needs water, so we needed a way to get water. We're going to put wood in there because we already have it. Another thermal expansion mod only object is the aqueous accumulator. So we can put that, trees in the way. Somewhere. And what it wants to do is have water in front of the block in order to be able to pull it into the machine, and then you can route that to the engine. This machine does not take energy, which is really convenient. It still has outputs, and I just converted everything to an output. So in order to do that, we can just make an infinite water source real fast. I'm sorry, flower. Whoops. Rip all the flowers. Oh, no. Okay. So now I have that, and it's going to pull water into the machine, I think. Maybe. I'll give it a minute just in case. And then what we need to do is we need to hook up these two things. What you'll do is you want to use a fluid duct in this case. A fluid duct you make just like this. You use copper and any glass. This can be any glass. And then you hook them up just like that, and you want to make sure that the outputs are outputting into the right direction. I should have it outputting in the right direction, I think. Maybe let me just pull it up real fast. Sometimes things are finicky in mod packs, and they don't work how you expect them to. Does it need to be on multiple sides? See, I always learn everything every day. I had this working earlier. Interesting. Oh, there we go. Cool. That's cool. Okay, so I filled up the Steam Dynamo, and then I don't think this needs to be here. I filled up the Steam Dynamo with water, and then now we can see that it's generating power. Yeah, and then this will just work. This doesn't require power, which is nice. So it'll just fill up with water and fill your thing up. And then you'll need to get combustion materials in here. This doesn't have like an automatic configuration tab like the other ones do, but I believe you can still use item ducts to get things into it. Yeah. So the next thing on the list is item ducts. So just like fluid ducts like we use, you can make item ducts using fused quartz, which I'm using a mod pack, so I think the recipe for this is different in different mod packs or whatever. It uses tin and probably glass, or hardened glass, I guess. So once you get item ducts, you can use that and put in a chest. And then you can have that chest move items in there. And I think there's one more step you have to do, because it's not going to do anything because there's no like auto input thing on this. And the chest doesn't know what to do. If you're going to hook up something that doesn't have like an automatic input, what you need to do is make a servo. And I didn't know this for the longest time, and it was insane. Yeah, you'll need to make one of these, which is made using this recipe. Again, this can be any glass. What you'll do is you'll right-click it on the side that you want to extract from, which in this case is the chest. And you want to like put on this little thing right here. And then you will go in, and this is redstone control. If I just want it to be on all the time, I'll just hit ignored. And now it'll pull this wood from the chest and pull it into the steam dynamo. All right, so now we have energy, but this is just filling up because it's not attached to anything. So the next type of duct is the flux duct. Lead flux duct is the simplest one. It's made with using this crafting recipe. This is any glass again. And then we can hook it up here, and we just hook it up to our machines. No weird input output things have to happen. And now we can see that these are getting powered. So then now this should start pulverizing our iron. And then what we'll see is that only this slot will go down into our furnace. And then the yellow slot that we didn't do anything with yet will just accumulate there. The reason I didn't go over that part yet is because we actually need item ducts for this also. So with item ducts, we can do this and this. And then we can hook up a chest there. We don't need a servo here because these do have auto output buttons. And it will not output, even though these are connected to each other, they won't output into each other because they're both going to slots that are only outputs on the machine. So now the unsmelted pulverized nickel will go into the chest, as well as the smelted iron will go into the chest. We could also just fill this up with whatever. And then, you know, when this is finished, it'll just pull what's next from the chest. So it's a really nice way to automate a lot of material processing. Now, not technically a thermal expansion, but thermal foundation. We have these upgrade kits that we can use in order to upgrade our machines. The order goes hardened, reinforced, signalium, and resonant. So what you do with these things, if your mod pack has them, and I honestly don't know what other mod packs have. So if they have them, you can use them to right click onto the machine and it will upgrade the machine. What it'll do is it will give you an extra augmentation slot. It'll also give you more RF storage. And the way the machine speeds work is the machine speeds are proportional to how much RF power you have in here. So the fact that it increases your storage also means that it increases the speed of the machine just by default without even adding anything else into the augmentation slots. And then we can also add in more of them. And you need the previous one before you can add the next one. So I don't think I can add this one to the furnace. Because I haven't added the yellow one in yet. We can do that, and we can do that. These all add their own things, so now it's 6,000 or 60,000 rather than 30,000 RF, and now we have extra augmentation slots. So now the augmentations of the machines, so the things that go in these slots, I'll briefly mention them, but there is a lot of them. Thermal expansion. There is a huge amount of them, and I'm not going to explain all of them. What they typically do, and if you have the just enough items, you can hold shift. I think if they're in your inventory, you can hold shift and see what they do also. A lot of them are like specialized things for specific machines. Like this one only works in the photogenic insulator, and it makes it work better. This also only works in the photogenic insulator, for example. One of the more universal ones is the auxiliary reception coil. You build it with this recipe. This, again, is built like that. And this will go into almost any machine, and what it does is it just speeds up the machine. So we can see that this was, I think, 60,000, and then we put it in there, and now it's 120,000. And again, the speed is proportional to the amount of RF you have in here. It's not proportional to the maximum amount of RF. It's proportional to the amount you have. So now it's right now it's zero speed because there's zero in there because I think it ran out of wood. Whoops. Let's see. Add some wood in there. Put it in the chest. Whoop. I think I was spawning in wood and then it was throwing it on the ground. Okay. So then it'll go in there and then we'll see that it gets faster, but this will make it a lot faster. There's other augmentations. I think they're called augmentations if you search it up like that, that do very useful things, but they are specific to different machines. One that I use a lot is the nullification chamber. And what the nullification chamber does is it destroys excess secondary outputs. So like, for example, this output right here is a secondary output. If we didn't want to deal with that, like if we had a really complicated setup with like 10 different machines or something, and we just did not care at all what this output, what you do is you put this one in there, and what happens is that if we just had this disconnected, what will happen is this will build up. Once it reaches 64, it will just delete any excess you have, and it will allow the recipe to continue going. Because normally, if you didn't have this, if this reaches 64, it'll halt the machine from going any further because the output is full. So what it'll allow you to do is ignore this, and it will allow the machine to continue going as long as you're dealing with the primary output. You know, most of the other ones are specialized, and I'm not going to talk about them too much, but they are very useful, and you should definitely take a look at a lot of them. All right, guys, that'll be it for this episode. I hope you found something of value in this video and that you're able to use it as a quick start guide to the thermal expansion. If you have any questions, leave them down in the comments and I'll be happy to try to help. You know, different mod packs will look different and have different things, so there's always a little bit of confusion going on when you're dealing with mods. I hope you have a wonderful day and I'll see you next time.